Good evening and welcome again to the second webinar of the series Favorite 5 Days 5, reaching the finale of the infertility treatment every Tuesday, an initiative of Rewari Obsangani Society. Today's topic is triggering ovulation, is it debatable? To enlighten us this topic, we welcome the scholar of the day, Professor Nina Malhotra, ART Center, Department of Obsangani, AIIMS, New Delhi. She is General Secretary, Indian Fertility Society. On behalf of Jaxonpal Pharmaceuticals Limited, makers of injection gonadoreg containing leuprolide acetate 3.75 mg, Cystelia M, the right combination of 40:1 ratio of myinositol and Lycored Preg sachet with L-arginine, DHA and lycopene. I am Dr. Vipin Tyagi, along with my teammates, Dr. Deepika Chhabra and Mr. Amit Saxena. Thank you, Dr. Seema Mittal, ma'am, President, Rewari Obsangani Society. She is the convener and moderator for this ICOG accredited webinar series supported by Lalita Memorial Hospital Infertility Center, Rewari. Esteemed chairpersons, Dr. Sunita Kuntal, former professor Obsangani, SMS Medical College, Jaipur. Dr. Tripti Sharan, senior consultant, Obsangani, BLK Super Speciality Hospital, New Delhi. Dr. Vaidehi Marathe, President Nagpur Obsangani Society, Vice President Narchi, Director Meher Maternity Nursing Home, Nagpur. In the panel, we have Dr. Dipankar Banerjee, Director and IVF Consultant, Ideal Fertility IVF Genetic Center, Jabalpur. Dr. Promila Malik, Immediate Past President, Gurgaon Obsangani Society, Director Chiranjeev Hospital, Gurugram. Dr. Sonu Balhara, Unit Head, Reproductive Medicine, Artemis Hospital, Gurugram. Welcome our precious attendees. Please make note, this session is streaming on Facebook Live. The recording will remain on our YouTube channel for reference and knowledge sharing. This series is brought to you by Jaxonpal Medical Services. We request all to please post your queries by text in the Q&A box, which will be answered at the end of the session. I will now request Dr. Seema Mittal, ma'am, to kindly initiate the session. Ma'am.
Thank you, Dr. Vipin. Thank you, Team Jaxonpal. And it's a pleasure for me. This is the much awaited day when we have actual my favorite Dr. Nina Malhotra, ma'am, with us. Actually, we had started with A to Z of infertility, where we had started from basic and going on further. And to start this series, I had talked to ma'am and she had said, yes, go ahead, I will be a part of it. And how busy ma'am is, everybody knows that from the premier institute of India, that's AIIMS, professor, ma'am is professor at AIIMS. And all the responsibilities she carries out so beautifully. She's the secretary of Indian Fertility Society also. And for this favorite five series, she is my favorite. And she will become your favorite once you attend this lecture. Ma'am is one who talks about the evidence-based practice, and she's a wonderful teacher. And before I invite Dr. Tripti to introduce the much awaited person for today, I would like to introduce, as Dr. Vipin Tyagi has already talked, we have Dr. Tripti Sharan. She's a senior consultant at BLK, and she's the doctor, and she is the most glamorous and interesting person who has a parallel life as a journalist also, who talks about medicine on lots of TV series. And we have much more senior person, Dr. Sunita Kuntal today. And it's really a privilege to have ma'am here as chairperson, and Dr. Vaidehi Marathe. She is the president of Nagpur Obsangani Society. And she is one person, like I am following her, that cookery series, you know, the booklet she has released. And she's the all-rounder and multi-talented. Good to have everyone here. And we have wonderful panelists, Dr. Dipankar Banerjee, who needs no introduction, Dr. Promila Malik, and Dr. Sonu Balhara. Welcome everybody, and over to you, Dr. Tripti.
Good evening this time to everyone, not only to myself. So I thank you, Dr. Seema, for making me part of this beautiful initiative. It's a really pleasure to be here. And I would say a matter of pride to be invited to introduce somebody like Dr. Nina Malhotra. Madam is a professor, as you just mentioned. She is a professor at the Premier Institute, AIIMS, New Delhi. And most of us know that she's trained in ART. And she did her training from Scotland and later on from Wales. She has done some prestigious fellowships, such as the Commonwealth Fellowship and this Boys ACAT, if I'm right in pronouncing it, fellowship. And she has also made us proud by winning so many awards, such as the Sir Malcolm's Black Fellowship Award, the Overseas Fund 2010 and 18, both are from London, then the Imaging Science Award and the Dawn Award, as well as the Corian Research Award. We know that her interest is in reproductive surgery as well as endometriosis. And she has done quite a lot of research in endometriosis, genital tuberculosis, and implantation failure. And she's part of these funded projects, which are the ICMR Task Force on PCOS, CSR, and many several industry-sponsored funded projects. Welcome, madam. It's an honor to be, you know, being at the same stage with you, Dr. Nina Malhotra.
Thank you, Dr. Tipti. And it's really good to have ma'am, because trigger may sound like ovulation trigger, or what is there in trigger, you know, we give trigger, but the precise trigger given at the right time and the right drug given for trigger can make all the difference to our infertility treatment. And who better than ma'am Nina Malhotra? Welcome, ma'am.
Thank you very much. A good afternoon or good evening to all. It's been a real pleasure to be part. I'm really apologetic. Seema had been pestering me for an earlier webinar, but somehow I could not find time. And I would really thank Jackson Pal for giving me the opportunity. So I think I will go straight to my lecture on the triggering in ART. I hope my slides are seen there. Yeah. So just would talk a bit on the basics and then go on to take you from there, that what are the emerging trends and evolving trends. Because I think if we look at it in the last decade, we have really mastered, you know, ovarian stimulation when we do it in IVF cycle. So my talk is mainly toward the IVF cycles and the people who are doing IVF, and also to people who do IUIs, and understanding what has been the reason why, despite a good stimulation, we do fail when we land up with empty follicle syndrome. That means when you're doing a pickup, we don't get any follicles. Also to understand that when we do a pickup, we do get a lot of immature oocytes. And do we think, are we made wrong? The stimulation is right. And I think in the last 2-3 years, there has been a lot of stress now on understanding that does the trigger matter? And yes, there is a science and the evidence which says that even trigger matters. So moving from this, I would just take you to this slide, which I'm sure all of us see it in any infertility presentation on stimulation, how the cycle begins with the growing follicles being recruited, be it in the natural cycle with a single follicle being going forward, looking at the response to the FSH, and then the LH comes in. And as the estrogen rises, following a rise or a negative release of the feedback, the negative feedback goes, and LH begins to rise, which corresponds subsequently to ovulation. And then there's a rise in progesterone because the corpus luteum is responsible for the release of the progesterone. So exactly mirroring it, if you see it, it is the LH, which is the reason why we have the ovulation, and then there is progesterone. So we know that ovulation will take place in a natural cycle somewhere around 12 to 14 hours after the peak, or something like 24 to 28 hours after the onset. And because of this understanding, we know that we give an ovulation trigger when we do a stimulated cycle, be it with clomiphene or letrozole or with HMG, or for that matter, when we do an IVF cycle, when we are recruiting many, many more follicles and we are going to do an ovum pickup. So this is what we kind of mirror, or we actually copy the normal physiology. But in the physiology, we must understand why is LH important. And I will take you through a few slides to explain this, that the estradiol levels, when they are persisting for more than 300 picograms for more than 48 hours, is that the positive feedback sets in for the LH surge. And this LH surge is the one which luteinizes the granulosa cells. And all this leads to maturation and the release of the egg. So if you look at it, LH is really important, because if we could realize our physiology from the way back in the first years to Ganong and genetics, we know that the oocytes in the graafene follicle are arrested in the prophase of meiosis one. And when you get the LH, it is the one which allows the resumption of meiosis. And why meiosis is needed? Because it causes the maturation of a new site, which is in the M1 phase to get M2. And I'm sure the embryologist, when they are getting the eggs from the follicular fluid, they are happy when they say they get M2 oocytes. Now, this M2 is the metaphase to oocytes, which are recognized by the presence of a single polar body. And why the single polar body? Because when there'll be fertilization with the spermatozoa, there'll be a two polar bodies forming, and that's the one which indicates fertilization has taken place. So that means to have an LH exposure is very important, be it is in a natural cycle for a spontaneous pregnancy, and also to have this in a stimulated cycle. But when this exposure gets too much in excess, both in duration or in the volume, we get what is OHSS. So this is what you should understand. That's the reason why when we do a trigger with agonist, we are actually trying to cover up this excess of LH. So basically in LH surge, when we do with HCG, we are using the same physiology and we are using some substances which have LH-like activities, and one of them is HCG. In IVF cycles, because they not only cause luteinization of the granulosa cells, they cause final oocyte maturation. And why maturation? Because they are causing presumption of the meiosis, which was arrested. So oocyte competence, LH, has a very important role. It causes not just oocyte maturation. It is important for the nuclear and cytoplasmic maturation. So it is with the LH that comes in here that you finally get the M2 oocyte with the single polar body, just a graphical representation. Now, again, if you look at the IVF, IVF is nothing but a supraphysiological response to stimulation. While you just get one dominant follicle developing, when we give with the natural levels or of the FSH, in IVF, we are hitting the same ovary with a much higher dose of FSH. So when we are giving higher doses of FSH, which are crossing the threshold of the FSH, you get a supraphysiological response. That means you'll get multiple oocytes or multiple follicles responding. And then this is what is it. So the continuum is taken right from there to the ovulation. Therefore, we need to give an LH and we need an HCG trigger. So considering that it's triggered, do we think we can give it only with HCG? No. The oocyte maturation, which is initiated by the LH exposure, is therefore provided by just not HCG. We have other compounds and other molecules like GnRH agonist, recombinant LH, and a newer compound which is now in the research process is casepeptin. Just to tell you that how do these molecules behave, they're basically trying to become like surrogates of LH. So they behave in the same manner as a natural LH does. But the difference lies in the fact that all of them have a different mode of action, i.e. in terms of their peak, which is achieved. If you look at it, it is a GnRH which has got the earliest to peak in terms of high flavin. Why I'm trying to stress this? Because if you understand this, you will be able to understand the concept of dual trigger, which is coming up in IVF cycles when we are trying to encash on poor responders and now even in normal responders, or for that matter, in donor oocyte cycles. So this is the one which peaks the earliest. The effects are the earliest to go away, in contrast to HCG, where the peak takes place around 24 hours and the effects last for more than 2 weeks. And of course, a recombinant LH, which is almost like a natural LH surge, and casepeptin, which also has a very early onset and a short-lasting effect. Now, again, at the site of action, if you look at it, it's casepeptin, which works at the casepeptin receptors in the hypothalamus, as contrast to GnRH agonists, which act on the receptors in the pituitary glands, where we have the FSH and LH receptors, and of course, the recombinant LH or the HCG is directly acting on the LH receptors in the ovary. So all these sites are the ones which make a difference. Now, whenever we look at any immune molecule, be it ovarian stimulation or trigger, I think for any treatment, we look at three things. Is it an effective molecule? Is it safe? And is it patient-centered? And I think when you talk of any LH or HCG triggering molecule or an ovulation triggering molecule, we want to look at its effectiveness, i.e. will it improve the pregnancy? Will it improve the live birth? And of course, cumulative live birth, i.e. when we do a frozen cycle after a fresh cycle, that means we have surplus good quality embryos which can be used to give you a cumulative live birth. Is it safe? And as I said in the first slide, that when the duration and the extent or the volume of LH increases, then that's when the complication of OHSS arise. So is this triggering molecule safe to avoid the complication of OHSS or any errors or mistakes that can happen, of course? And is it convenient to use in terms of cost and physical burden? So let's look on to a trigger which we are commonly using and we are very much familiar is an HCG molecule which we use, which gives you only an LH surge because this is behaving like LH, nothing more than that. It is an HCG molecule. But what is very good about it is that it not only just brings about the release or maturation of the oocyte, it also goes into the luteal phase because effects last for up to 2 weeks, and therefore it works like a luteal phase support and therefore also supports the corpus luteum. By the understanding that a lot of original people in the past practitioners continue to even give HCG in women with threatening miscarriages, and also it stimulates production of progesterone. In contrast to GnRH, how does a GnRH agonist receptors or agonist trigger work? Basically, GnRH agonist, if you realize from the physiology of these molecule, it causes an upregulation. And when it causes an initial upregulation, physiologically it induces both a release of FSH and LH. Now we should remember that in the LH surge, while LH is necessary, so is FSH in the natural cycle. So it is very much like a natural LH surge, effects lasting for 24 hours. But what is the biggest downside is that when it goes away, it knocks off the corpus luteum. Unlike HCG, which is supportive of the corpus luteum, it actually causes luteolysis. And that's the reason when we give a trigger with an GnRH agonist, be it Lupride or triptorelin or any compound, the luteal phase will be totally chaotic and will be disturbed. So if you look at it, if you compare the two, the natural LH surge lasts for 14 hours, takes 14 hours and vanishes off in the next 20 hours. So that's exactly why when we give a trigger, we know that the pickup should be done somewhere around 34 to 36, or they give a big range of 36 to 48 hours for an ovum pickup. And you can see how HCG is going beyond the first week and GnRH just lasting short. So moving from there, if you look at it, HCG and LH are homologous, but what it leads to is because the effects are acting to hit on the multiple corpus luteum, which are developing from multiple follicles that are developing in IVF cycle, what is it akin to? It leads to a higher level of estrogen and progesterone coming more rampantly from the follicular going to form corpus lutea, and therefore a very, very high chance of OHSS. So therefore, HCG in a patient who is at risk or who is likely to be an OHSS candidate should be avoided, and I will tell you how. Whereas a GnRH agonist is a molecule which acts immediately at the receptors, and because of its short life, it causes an immediate luteolysis and therefore decreases the risk of OHSS. So let's talk about trigger. When do you do it and how do you do it? So let's talk of simple cycles, which is ovulation induction, which you can do it with maybe oral agents, clomiphene or letrozole. And also when we're doing it with HMG or gonadotropin-based cycles. So the criteria to offer a trigger in an oral agent would be when the follicle diameter, I'm sure we all don't need to sort of know it, should be at least or equivalent to or more than 18 millimeters, obviously keeping the endometrium in mind. But remember that this is the formula that we use, at least 200 picograms per ml. This formula is important because this is what we use even in an IVF cycle, or for that matter, an ovulation by an HMG cycle. And therefore, by the ASRM guidelines, they say that any stimulated cycle where the level of estradiol are going beyond 1500, I'm talking of a HMG stimulated cycle for an IUI, you should think of cancelling. That means you have more than 4 to 5 dominant follicles, because we are fearing not just OHSS, but the risk of multiple pregnancies. But if I put this 200 to maybe 30 or 20 follicles which are developing, it'll definitely more than 4,000 picograms per ml. So when we do it in an ovulation stimulated cycle, we could use it at HCG, which we use in, say, in a clomiphene or letrozole cycles, anywhere between 5,000 to 10,000. Now I said 10,000 because there'll be some women who will be obese, who have a bigger in size. In such cases, you may need to give them a higher dose of HCG. You can even use recombinant HCG in the form of 250, which is Ovitril, or these are the variants which we use, but we use them uncommonly in stimulated cycles. The only thing is if you use them in stimulated cycles, which are just for ovulation induction or IUI, remember using agonist means you have to definitely give them intensive luteal support, maybe with small doses of HCG or estrogens and progesterones, because with luteolysis happening, the luteal phase will definitely be deficient. Now, what about trigger? How do you think you're going to decide a trigger on IVF cycles? We know that when there are small cycles, small follicles, you will rather land up with immature oocytes. But if they're too large, they will be what we call as post-mature, which again, our embryologists don't like. So the criteria which most of us in IVF units follow is when at least two or three lead follicles are 17 to 18 millimeters is the criteria met to give an ovulation trigger. Because we know that follicles which are, you know, having less than 1 ml volume, which means they are smaller than 14 millimeters, in contrast to those who have larger, will not be giving you the right kind of oocyte. And this is just observation coming from large studies or large data. And we know that the competence or the fertilization rate is greatest when the follicles are somewhere between 16 to 23. If it's more than 23, the chances of fertilization are less, and so are when they are less than 14 millimeters, because you get what we call as metaphase one or at times GV, which are immature oocytes. So just thinking, taking you on the pharmacokinetics, again, revising you when you use HCG or you use GnRH or LH, the beauty of GnRH is shorter onset of action and shorter duration is contrast to the HCG molecule. Now, the big question arises is that which one should you use when you do an IVF cycle? Should you use a urinary product which is available, can be used intramuscularly, or should we use recombinant? Because you know by the formula, 250 micrograms of recombinant which is used subcutaneously is equivalent to 6,500 international units of urinary. So really looking at which is better, urinary or recombinant, there has been a lot of trials. But if you look at the Cochrane, which is last come up in 2016, which looked at 18 randomized trials, they said there was no conclusive evidence between recombinant and urinary in terms of not just the live birth rates or ongoing pregnancies, but also in terms of OHSS and miscarriage, because we all started using recombinant with the fear that the doses is less, the dose are 6,500, and therefore OHSS should be less. No, but if you look at the pool data, it says that the OHSS risk is also similar. The only thing is that, yes, cost is definitely a factor, but with recombinant, when you use it subcutaneously, and also they said that the chances of injection site reactions are less common with the recombinant preparation. Now, there's a very big question that when you use patients with big size, or they're women who are bigger in size, or big BMI are high, there should you titrate or modulate the dosaging? Should you really change? In fact, if I looked at literature, I got very different answers. In fact, there were studies where I look at this big study, which is a retrospective cohort, which looked at almost 300 patients. They found that there was no difference if they changed the dosing. They went on from giving women 5,000, 10,000, 15,000 international unit of urinary to obtain based on their BMI. And they found that there was actually no difference irrespective of BMI. And what actually influenced was the maternal age at the time of IVF, because they looked at a lot of other factors and they found it was basically the age. However, if you look at this paper, I think this is something which I really read again and again. I really enjoyed it. It was again a very big data which comes from 10,000 plus patients in IVF-ICSI. And again, this was retrospective. And what they found was they actually gave women 10,000, 5,000, 4,000, 3,300, and also they gave dual trigger, which I will talk later. And what they found was that definitely the level of the beta HCG that they checked after the time of trigger was making a difference in terms of the fertilization rates. And what they concluded was that, you know, sliding the patient's dosages based on their BMI should be considered. And when the women, in fact, they found, and when they did ROC curves were drawn from this paper, they realized for women who are an average build, and not just this thing, doses as low as 300 IU were sufficient. But if they're large women, you must consider them giving definitely 5,000. That was the minimum amount that they could calculate. So I think this goes to say, if you have a woman who is more than 30 or 32 BMI, I think we'll have to give them not 5,000, but at times even 10,000, provided the risk of OHSS is not much. Now, let's look at the big problem of an HCG trigger. And the big problem of HCG is OHSS, because what happens is that when there are multiple follicles, and the big problem is not just follicles which are more than 17 or 18. The big number is follicles that we always disregard, and they are the ones which cause nuisance. And these are follicles between 11 to 15 millimeters. So when HCG hits, it doesn't hit just the 18 or the 17. It hits the others. And therefore, with the multiple hits, what it releases, it releases a lot of these cytokines, which increase the vascular permeability. And all the secondary mediators which are coming, besides the VEGF, lead to what is called as OHSS, which is one of the big challenges with HCG. So if you look at the current concept, when we want to do an OHSS-free clinic, I think the way forward from most of the clinical research is, and what we all have accepted, is segmentation of the IVF cycle, i.e. we believe we should go in for antagonists, especially in women who are at high risk of developing OHSS, i.e. the PCOS variety. Because when we go on for an antagonist protocol, it is only then can we give them an agonist trigger. And of course, if the numbers of oocyte that you get are huge, I think freeze all, because this is how you will not just completely avert, but you will not completely arrest OHSS, but you will avert the risk of a severe OHSS. She may get to still have a mild to moderate OHSS. And when you freeze all, you have segmented the IVF, because you need to go to the second segment, which is a frozen embryo cycle, which is even means the frozen embryos will be thawed and put back in the second segment. So this is what we understand by segmenting the IVF treatment. So let's think, know what analogs are, how are they working. So the GnRH analogs, there are a whole lot of them, right from nafrolin, which is a nasal spray, to GnRH leuprolide or triprolin. Because they have a very short half-life, they act immediately. So they immediately block the receptors. So the action happens immediately. And the available right from Lupron that we use to boost, and depending on whichever unit you work, but in my unit, we use Leuprolide is the one which is freely available. And this is what we are using for stimulating and down-regulated cycles, whereas some people are happier to use triprolin in India. But I think in UK, they are still dependent on Buserelin and Nafrolin when they do a GnRH agonist trigger. Now, if you use an agonist, the doses are, I mean, there's literature of Leuprolide. If you use 1 milligram, equates to 0.3 milligrams of triprolin. In fact, some literature also says it's equivalent to 0.2 milligrams of Leuprolide. 1 milligram of Leuprolide is equal to 0.2 milligram. But so this is how I think if you are using one, you can give 0.3 milligrams of triprolin. And this can be used intramuscularly or subcutaneously, whichever route you prefer. Yes, because we know that there will be a luteal phase insufficiency when you know you're undergoing a trigger with agonist, most of us believe to freeze, because we know if the luteal phase is chaotic in an IVF cycle, implantation will be impeded, and if there's an impediment in the implantation, pregnancy and live births will be definitely low. But I think this is what Peter Homedayan gave, a protocol which I will talk in detail, which is called as a dual trigger, where when you have a risk which is not very major, you could still go on and do a embryo transfer in the fresh cycle, provided the number of oocytes that you receive are lesser. That is what we call as going ahead and giving a modified luteal phase support in a GnRH trigger cycle in which we do a fresh transfer. However, which is very important, is not just the number of, is not the level of the E2 that you get, but definitely depending on the number of oocytes you get. So if you are pricking and getting more than 25 oocytes, then definitely go for freeze-all, irrespective of the patient's desire. Again, between 15 to 25, you could give them the option, but I think if you're not very confident, you do freeze-all. But there is a scope of what we call as a luteal support, which could go beyond the trigger, giving small doses of HCG and maybe estrogen and progesterone, and I will tell you that in detail. So what is a luteal phase support if you are having a unit which is going ahead and has got a good number of supportive system or a backup system, which you are not a standalone unit, you work in an institution? Yes, you could give support, which is by giving either small doses of HCG, which is giving either on the day of the OPU, which is like 1,000 to 1,500, depending if you got 15 or lesser oocytes on the day of the HCG trigger. And an intensive approach, which is an American approach, in which you give aggressively estrogens and progesterones. And a lot of people are happier to give that estrogen progesterone because they feel that if they give HCG, they could be further adding fuel to fire and adding to the VEGF which are being released. So both these regimens are there. However, if you are more comfortable with Freeze-All, my take would be go ahead and freeze rather than take the risk or challenge of an OHSS. So in the latest papers that were there, they found that they were able to have low risk OHSS despite giving lower dose of HCG. Now, when we talk of a trigger, which is with GnRH agonist, i.e. when we give it to prevent OHSS, just an agonist trigger, I think this is a very nice paper when we should all understand that it doesn't mean everything is nice and good. So we should really know what are the strengths, and I could put it as this paper which talks on the SWOT analysis, looking at what are the strengths of this agonist, what are the weaknesses, and what are the opportunities and threats. So we look at it, it's got a very big strength that it is working physiological. And if it's not just looking at preventing the risk of OHSS, but a very big strength that is coming up now is it is improving the number of mature oocytes, the yield of oocytes which are M2 are improving. And therefore in women who had had a previous cycle where you got empty follicle or you had immature oocyte syndrome, I think a sensible way is to trigger in the next cycle with agonist definitely, or maybe for that matter, dual trigger. But what are its big weaknesses? The big weaknesses is because the luteal phase goes chaotic, you have lower success rate if you want to do a fresh cycle. And therefore, if you go for a frozen embryo trichle, it has a cost. The cost is the cost of adding to her freezing embryos and also causing her for the next cycle. So this may look like a hidden cost, but it's a very big trade-off. And you walk a tightrope whether you want to swing on the side of OHSS or to increase the cost. And I think every individual patient has to be individualized. One size will not fit. What about the opportunities? Yes, the opportunities are again very many because we know that the agonist trigger leads to M2 oocyte. I think when we do the donor programs, then I think in the donor oocyte program, this is the best bet. Not only are you getting a bigger bulk of or a bigger amount of mature oocytes, you're also obviating the risk of OHSS, which could develop in some patients who are young because we are choosy about donors and we definitely want women to give a harvest of good number of oocytes, and young women are again prone to develop OHSS. Well, a big threat is a lot of misconceptions because if you look at Cochrane and meta-analysis, they would still not be supporting a standard agonist trigger as of now. So let's look at what the literature says. Now, as I said that there is a dual trigger, the concept of dual trigger. So this was isolated GnRH when we are giving agonist only for preventing of OHSS. We are not giving any HCG. In contrast to a dual trigger, and again, I will say dual trigger would come in three categories. And I thought, let me cover this OHSS part right here, that when you give a small dose of HCG in a woman who has got a severe risk, you could give it as a small bolus, either 35 hours after triggering, which is just 1 hour after oocyte trigger. But mind you, if you give it as soon as this, you land up in literature with a 26% risk of OHSS, which is major. As compared to giving a small dose of HCG on the day or off a GnRH, which we call as a dual trigger, that means at the time when you're giving a GnRH, i.e. 34 to 36, you just get a lower risk of OHSS, mind you, but the OHSS risk does not go. It doesn't mean that you've given a dual trigger, the patient will be free. She will still have, and this is 0.5% of severe OHSS. So the mild to moderate doesn't go. In contrast to a newer concept where people are saying that don't give them an HCG, wait for 5 days after triggering the GnRH. That means you call the patient on day three, see how she is, does she have any symptoms? And if she has something like 15 to 20 oocytes, which are fertilized, she's fine. You can decide whether you go for freeze if she's not doing well. But if she's doing well, perhaps on a day five, you could give her a small dose of HCG and that would work. So this is something which is what we would can still put as a dual trigger or a kind of a supplement. I won't call it dual trigger, actually, a supplementation to support the luteal phase. So this is the bolus which you could give it either along with the GnRH, that means 36 hours before, which is GnRH and the HCG happen together, 1500, or you do it on the day, which are again not very, very nice. But if you go day 5, you could probably salvage and do a refresh cycle. But mind you, she is still at a risk of having a late onset OHSS. So I think it is what we have to learn as we move further. So let's talk about dual trigger. That means you're giving both GnRH and HCG together. Of course, preventing OHSS, as I've talked, what is its place? Can we do it in diminished ovarian reserve? Yes, there is a lot of data. Donor cycles, as I told you, works out good because you're giving them the benefit of getting more mature oocytes routinely, i.e. in normal responders, because there are some papers, and definitely when there's empty follicle syndrome or immature oocytes. So I think this is a brilliant paper which is written by Roy Lorevito, who is now, I think, an authority on agonist triggers, or rather ovulation triggers, who says that if you give dual trigger, triggering with HCG, GnRH or both, and to whom, he says, when you give a dual trigger, you are definitely offering a woman a standard dose of HCG with a GnRH. What you do is, you are definitely getting a comparable or better oocytes after GnRH, and low dose would again be helping to rescue a luteal phase but preventing OHSS. And as I detailed, if you move further to day 5, where you assess your patient clinically, going on day 5 could be better. Now let's look at women with dual trigger being given. That means both HCG and GnRH agonist have been given together is poor responders. And here you see that you have got definitely not only better clinical pregnancies, but better live birth rates in this study. This is the latest paper from 2020. We had a journal club just last week, and I thought I should get that there is work which is coming again from Roy Lorevito's group, where they're using even in normal responders. And what they do is they give both GnRH and HCG together in the form of leuprolide and 250 micrograms of recombinant. They've excluded women with poor response and those who had a risk of OHSS. Of course, women with high BMI were excluded, and they found significantly better number of mature M2s, more fertilization, more cleavage. And also, if you look at it, the clinical pregnancy rates per patient were significantly higher, and so were the live births. So the take from this big randomized trial, double-blinded, was that there's an enhanced response with dual trigger may lead to better IVF, even in normal responder patients. Now, let's look at patients who are not at risk. And those who are not at risk, as I pointed out totally, if you go at poor responders, yes, you could combine. If normal responders, yes, we could look at the future. But when you had an abnormal oocyte numbers as an empty follicle or abnormally matured oocyte, what the body of evidence is coming with smaller trials is that certainly you should always give them separate. That means you give them a GnRH agonist earlier and give them a HCG trigger later on. So you keep a gap of at least 5 to 6 hours, and this would definitely be more beneficial rather than giving both of them together in improving the oocyte maturity, because both of them are acting by different. That means you give HCG exactly 34 to 36 hours prior to the pickup, and go and give a GnRH agonist at least 4 hours before it, i.e. something like 40 hours before a pickup. Just a small study that I could get in IUI cycles. Do you think there is a difference? Because a lot of people believe that they would give GnRH agonist versus HCG. And this was not in women who were at risk of developing OHSS. I just thought routinely, because a lot of clinicians do ask me this question. Well, this study looked at it and they found that there was no difference as such in clinical pregnancy or the pregnancy or take-home baby rates. Yes. What is important is that when you do this with an HCG vis-a-vis a GnRH agonist, you have to spend more money on their luteal phase support. So let's look at the three things that I talked about: effectiveness, safety, and patient-centered. I'm sure recombinant and the urinary work equally good. What's very good is that safety-wise, GnRH is the safest. Effective, but when we look at patient-centered, it's still not patient-centered, because we know that we have to build on either a frozen cycle or give them aggressive luteal support, which may be a very, very big factor, because it really is more expensive when we talk of giving more drugs in the luteal phase or going for a frozen embryo cycle. A quick word, and I think we're going to end up here, this recombinant LH, can we give it? Because it is akin to the normal cycle. I won't really go, but there's just very data which came from the very big multicentric European recombinant LH study. And what it really came was there was actually no difference in reduction of OHSS compared to HCG. But mind you, should you really stay a yes? No, absolutely no, because it is prohibitively costly. If you look at the cost, it works out 5 times the cost of a recombinant HCG, and therefore it has got no advantage. So there's no point of increasing the cost of an IVF cycle. Yes, Kipspeptin is a big promise, because in women who are at high risk of OHSS, whatever trials that have been done, they found that not a single patient developed OHSS when it was triggered with Kipspeptin. The trials have confirmed the safety. It has already undergone a phase 3 trial. In some European countries, it is being in the process of moving for marketing. Well, let's see whether we get it, because there are patients who, despite being given an agonist trigger, will land up with OHSS. I think Kipspeptin may be an answer. Just the last bit of my slide on the OFS. I think this is a very, very disrupting or a disturbing complication that we get, that we've done everything right. The patient behaved well. And when I got in and put my needle in the follicles, I'm not getting any oocyte there. When it is just genuine, it is very frustrating. That means false EFS could be, that means there is actually a problem. Like your patient did not take the dose rightly, or their method was wrong. Or for that matter, we now realize that there are some obese women where you actually did not titrate it, you did not give her the extra dose. That could be what is called as a false EFS, which you could distinguish. And a lot of units in practice actually do a urine pregnancy test before they put the patient for a pickup, because if there is a negative test, in fact, they would ask a repeat trigger. Now, genuine is that when she's really taken in and she's got blood beta HCGs, which are coming positive up to 30 to 40 milli international units. And these are the ones who do not respond. That means if you give a rescue dose and do a pickup 34 or maybe 24 hours later, they will give you no eggs. So these are the ones where I think we get back these patients and we realize that they are something like receptor defects. And here are the patients who could benefit most with giving them a dual trigger, definitely. So I will just end up here by saying that we know that HCG is most widely because it's the most effective. On safety, yes, we may have been in trouble in some time, but on the cost factor, it's the best. Recombinants are equally efficacious. And when we know, we talk about dual trigger, I think in the next 4 or 5 years, we will be more conversant to use dual triggers when we get more and more knowledgeable and experienced on the luteal support in fresh cycles. And also, we would probably have Kipspeptin in the near future to give answers. Now, before I end, I'm inviting you to this brilliant Congress as a Secretary General of the Infertility Society, Indian Fertility Society, where we are doing the first virtual global Congress. Why I call it first virtual global? Because this is a Congress where we have nothing but all international speakers. In fact, my flyers are falling short of the international faculty. We have 54 to 55 international faculty who are the who's who. I would look at celebrities from all the societies who are presidents of American Society, IFS, British Fertility Society, the Middle Eastern, the Mediterranean, and the ASUK are giving lectures. I don't think any time you could have the privilege, thanks to the virtual world today, and the faculty who you could imagine, right from Canada to New Zealand, are participating. So don't miss this opportunity. Please register. And we've made a very humble registration fee. So just 3,000, which is not including 3 days of Congress, but also the workshops. So you have 10 workshops, 2 of them are free. And you can certainly enjoy this conference. Thank you very much.
Thank you, ma'am. Actually, I was lost in our presentation, and it was actually such a simplified and such a stimulating talk that we are actually left with no questions, ma'am. And really thank you that you took out time out of your busy schedule to be with us. And yes, IFS conference is going to be a great pleasure for all of us. And we have kept the flyer, and I request all the participants also to join IFS, because such inputs, important latest details we keep on getting, and under the leadership of Ma'am Nina Malhotra, we are actually getting newer and newer things to learn. This time it is virtual, but actually when it comes to meeting Ma'am, we really feel energetic. Thank you, Ma'am, for being with us, and over to Dr. Vedehi for the questions.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Seema. Thank you, Dr. Nina Malhotra, Ma'am. This was an excellent talk. You've covered right from the basics, starting from the physiology, up to the luteal phase and up to the future. So you've covered the basics and beyond of triggering the ovulation. Thank you so much. This was really a wonderful talk. I see one question here. Ma'am, Dr. Sonu would like to know if you have any experience of giving a dual trigger to poor responders.
Yeah, thanks Sonu for this question. In fact, we have an ongoing randomized trial which is already ongoing. We had given it and we had data when we really found it was working good. So we have a DM candidate who has taken a thesis as dual triggers in poor responders. So we are recruiting patients. Because of the pandemic, we have a little slowed down. I'm sure we'll come back with results. We have randomized to two arms in which one we are giving the standard trigger and the other we are giving both 250 micrograms of which is Ovitril plus 1 milligram of Leuprolide. So I think when we get the answers, we will be again adding to the literature. Yeah, when we are doing this, we are definitely not doing a fresh transfer. That's what we have taken in this. So we have actually consented the patient because see, she's a poor responder and she's spending her money out of her own pocket when she comes. So here we have given them the choice. And we know that our answer is definitely live birth rates that we're looking at. But more than that, we're also looking at a very important aspect, how many extra embryos we are freezing. Because even if you get one or two, but if you hear, if you get from two to three or four, and you get an extra embryo from an M2 oocyte, that's what we are actually looking at. So maybe we'll be able to answer this a little later.
Yes, ma'am, because even if we get one more mature oocyte, that would, I think the patient would benefit from that.
Perhaps we'll get more fluent when we give it more often, the dual triggers, and I think we'll get answers. As I said, we're also learning this.
I'm taking the second question. If the UPT is negative after giving the trigger, and if we give the second dose, then after how much time we should do the pickup?
See, this is one thing when I've seen that when you get a UPT negative, so you could, I mean, in a situation, one would think I have to look at my logistics and I have to look at, because if I wait for another evening, which is like morning I've called for the pickup, and I know that the UPT is negative or the beta HCG is low. If I wait, now the big catch is, should I wait for the evening and then call her 36 hours later? So on a more logistic sense, what we do is we give the trigger in the morning there itself and we do the pickup 24 hours later. This is what we work out because, you know, we are not sure whether we give her a trigger in the evening. The other thing we've done is in most of these cases here we give, because if you wait for the 34, 36 hours later, that would. But yes, I think with the dual trigger happening, we have not done dual triggers, but we've done HCG triggers and called them the next day. We have not been fortunate all the time, but yes, when it is a false EFS, we have been lucky. We have been, in fact, we've had pregnancies also with these patients. But I think with this dual trigger business, I think we could salvage that cycle and probably go on to give them in the evening and then take it because the effect, the way they're asking is similar. And the paper that I was reading, in fact, was updating yesterday is by the Orivitos paper is in such patients, if you give, I know it is a false EFS, but here I could give probably 4 to 6 hours prior a GnRH agonist trigger and give her in the evening an HCG and then do a pickup 36 hours later. So everybody has a different way. And the only thing is that, yes, you should not have pricked these follicles because once you pricked up and then you want to go, then you're not likely. So you should refrain from touching these ovaries. That's what is a take.
Thank you, ma'am. I think there are no more questions. Dr. Seema, ma'am, over to you.
Thank you, Dr. Vedai. Thank you so much for being with us. And over to Sunita Kuntal, ma'am, to thank our esteemed, the most favorite ma'am, Neena Malhotra. And ma'am, you have to be with us because we have certain questions that we have in day-to-day life and we hesitate to ask, but here in this panel, we try to start from basic till the ultimate research and what we are actually doing, and no better person than you to share the evidence-based practice. And indeed, the brilliant presentation and the brilliant answers. And over to Sunita Kuntal, ma'am.
Thank you. Honorable Professor Neena Malhotra and dear friends, it is my pleasant duty to extend grateful thanks to our respectable speaker, Dr. Neena Malhotra. Madam Malhotra, as we all know, is a clinical academician of great national and international repute. Madam, your discourse has indeed been brilliant, educative, and enlightening on a subject of great sinister significance, as ovulation trigger is the core content of assisted reproduction, programs affecting the reproductive outcome and safety. And various options have amply been discussed by you in detail. Thanks for that. I would endorse that Kisspeptin has a great potential, seems to have a great future as a novel, physiological, affordable, effective, and safe agent for ovulation trigger after large clinical trials. Right here, friends, I'd like to thank the organizers and Dr. Deepti Chhabra and Dr. Seema Mittal in particular for inviting me to chair this session. With immense pleasure, Madam Malhotra, once again, a big thank you to you from all of us. Thank you very much indeed. Thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you, Sunita ma'am. And before we proceed to panel and invite our esteemed panelists, Dr. Sonu Ballahara, Dr. Pramila Malik, and Deepankar Banerjee, sir, and with ma'am as the expert faculty, we would like to invite you. Ma'am has already shown the flyer. Deepika ji, are we going to have that IFS conference flyer again? So everybody is requested to be part of this virtual conference and the mega event where we, like, now knowing ma'am Neena Malhotra, you know how many speakers we're going to have and what we are going to learn from them. It's worth attending, and ma'am has told that very small token amount has been kept for registration and everybody has to join. The details have been shared already with you. And before shifting to panel discussion, we will have a small video by Jackson Pal. It's worth watching, and over to Team Jackson Pal. As we all know that there is normal LH surge and there is release of ovum and normal fertilization, but in stimulated cycles, we postpone this surge and replace it with HCG or agonist, as ma'am has discussed in detail. But there are certain questions in our mind and we would like our experts to opine on those questions so that we go with some take-home message. First question to Dr. Sonu Ballahara. What is the minimal effective dose of HCG that we give? I would like you to speak on, like, normal cycles when we talk about, and there is normal LH surge and ideally it should not be given because ma'am is there, so she will opine. But when we are treating our infertility patients, we tend to give HCG to every patient. Like when we talk of support, luteal phase support, we say normal cycle, no need of giving support. But still we are giving HCG to all our patients, whether they are coming for normal fertility treatment or they are coming for IUI or they are coming for IVF. And then a luteal phase support also. So, Dr. Sonu, what is your take on minimum effective dose?
Dr. Seema, I usually give 5,000 as the triggering ovulation for the IUI cycles. And there are studies that 2,000 may be also given. That may also be effective. But I have never given. And if the patient is obese with a higher BMI or something, then 10,000. But in IVF cycles, usually almost all cycles, I give 10,000 as the triggering dose.
So recombinant HCG are you giving?
No, I'm usually giving urinary. Recombinant, usually I don't give. Otherwise, recombinant 250 micrograms, that is for the IVF cycles. But due to the cost in for IUI cycles or for just stimulated cycles, I don't use recombinant
Thank you, Dr. Sonu. Ma'am, Neena ma'am, what is your take for us that normal cycle, should we be using HCG, or for IUI cycle where we are not giving gonadotropin, should we be giving HCG or not, and what should be the dose? Hello, ma'am, Neena ma'am is there?
There are studies, Seema, that maybe even if you don't give HCG, ovulation will happen, and for the ovulation induction, if we are doing just timed intercourse cycles.
Mm-hmm. Okay, Deepankar sir is there, sir?
Yes, yes.
Sir, I want your expert comments on that issue. Should we give it for normal infertility patients?
Can you repeat the question?
Question is that there is normal LH trigger and normal ovulation in any patient who is coming to us for treatment of infertility. But we have made it a trend that any patient who comes and we see follicle is 17-18 millimeter, we give HCG trigger and then support as well. So do you recommend that what it should be given first of all, and if HCG should be given, then how much is the dose?
What you are talking about, that is an empirical injection of HCG.
Right, sir. Yes, sir.
Empirical injection of HCG, I usually don't support, because you have to have little bit more confidence of whether there is LH surge or not. And I better go with the ovulation kit, which is available in the market. If there is no LH surge internally, then HCG is okay. But looking at the size of the follicle and deciding the HCG dose, usually you are doing sometimes more harm than a good to the cycle.
And so what is the minimum dose that you give to your patient in your IUI cycle or IVF cycles? 5,000 IU or 10,000 IU?
The question is that how much HCG should be given?
Yes, sir.
And my take is that what Dr. Malhotra has already touched upon, that is body mass index is one of the biggest factor of dosing HCG to a lady. Mostly I'm talking about IVF,
right, sir.
But we get mostly 2 to 3 types of patients where I see when I do a very low AMH IVF, that is a poor ovarian response, or I should say is poor ovarian prognosis patients. With those patients, if I am about to get less than 4 oocytes, or if I am about to have a estradiol less than 1000 picogram, then most of the time the 5,000, 10,000 HCG will work, but it will not rescue those smaller follicle which is just below the 18 millimeter. Because what happens when you do IVF or IUI, there are follicles which are in cohort which are not of same size. There might be leading follicle 1-18 or 2-18, and less than 18 there might be few. What happens with those rescue with those follicles? We want to have good quality M2 site from that also. So there is a trend of one school of thought that decide your HCG dose with how much oocyte you are going to get. If there is hyperstimulation, your HCG should be less. That is 10,000 if you are using urinary. What I am doing in my day-to-day practice is I am doing an IVF of a low ovarian reserve, getting 2 or 3 or 4 oocytes. I use 15,000 IU HCG or 2 ampules of Ovidril. The prefilled syringe of Ovidril, because one Ovidril is 6,500, so I use 13,000. The rationale behind that is more the oocytes are less or poor ovarian reserve or poor ovarian prognosis patient, then there is, you must have noticed when you do an ultrasound while doing the follicular monitoring, we put a color Doppler also to see the vascularization of the follicular wall. When you do that, there are few follicles, there are less blood supply to those follicles. That means they are not having a good blood flow. So if you increase little bit of HCG in the circulation, the follicles which are following the lead follicle might also have good maturation of the oocyte which are in the GV state. I did this in my clinical day-to-day practice, and the number of M2 oocyte, it might not give a good pregnancy rate, but number of M2 oocyte which I am giving to my embryologist slightly increased even in the low ovarian reserve patients. So it is my way of working, and I have got this idea from a pivot group of Australians who are having an idea that you should have at least few number of M2 sites to the embryologist so that you can have at least a euploid looking blastocyst. I'm not doing PGS-A, but euploid looking good quality 5AA blastocyst. So this is my way of working, which I do. Another thing which happens in a very problematic way while I'm doing the HCG triggering is when there are follicles which are of not same size, you are doing IUI and there are three or four follicles, then which to rescue, the lead follicle or the following follicles? This also sometimes creates problem. Sometimes, I think I answered your question, otherwise I will continuously talking.
Thank you. Can we have the next question now? Next question to sir is normally which day we are not doing supposing ultrasound and we tell patient to do urinary LH, sir. So which day the patient should measure the LH surge and when should HCG? You said if LH surge is there, there is no need to give HCG. So want to talk on this?
You are asking me?
Yes, sir. This question is for you.
So whenever the patient gets an ovulation kit, most of the time there are 5 kits in one pack.
Okay.
So I ask my patients who are undergoing IUI or in a natural cycle IUI to use those kits from day 7 or day 8 so that moment they get even faintest 2 line in LH kit, then LH surge is there and on that day give HCG if you can catch it. Or if you cannot, then have an LH surge, don't use HCG. Because if you don't have control over premature LH surge and you are empirically using HCG, then most of the time that cycle fails, you get either immature eggs or prematurely mature eggs.
So sir, you think that these LH kits can replace our ultrasound findings, what we call the patient for? Because we get patients from far off.
If you're telling the patient, first of all, I'd like to thank Seema for inviting me for this panel. Thank you so much. Actually, in USA, when they are telling the patient to have timed coitus or when they're inducing with oral ovulation-inducing drugs like clomiphene citrate and letrozole, they are not at all using the ultrasound monitoring. They're just using the LH kit. If the patient is having a natural cycle monitoring, then the patient is told that will depend on the length of the cycle. If the patient is having a 28-day cycle, you tell the patient to start seeing for the LH surge on day 11. She has to just pass morning urine on that kit. And then as soon as the LH surge is positive, she is told to have ovulation happens around 14 to 26 hours after that LSR and maximum within 48 hours. So she is told to have timed intercourse in the next three days, same day and the next 2 days. And when you are giving the oral ovulation inducing drugs, suppose you are giving from day 3 to day 7, you start monitoring the LH surge from the 5th day of the last dose. Suppose you've given from day 3 to 7, you start monitoring for LH surge on day 12. And as soon as the LH surge is positive, whether you have to do the IUI or patient has to have timed intercourse, that will depend on that. So they're not using that ultrasound monitoring at all when they're inducing with the clomiphene citrate and letrozole.
Very right. Fully
agree. Especially, fully
I
agree.
Add 2-3 points in this. You can have false positive. This thing, you have to have the baseline FSH, LH and E2 in all the patients, because a patient with a premature ovarian failure will have false positive high LH, which will show as positive. And a patient with a PCOS with high LH will also show false positive LH. And then the patient with a perimenopausal will also have higher LH and she will show a false positive. So you should always have a day 2-3 baseline hormone level and then monitor with LH surge. And that's all.
Very right. So these particular patients which you have talked, Dr. Pamela, we should call these patients for ultrasound as well, so that we know the clear picture. And this
becomes more convenient and cost
effective.
USA, they are not monitoring with ultrasound at all. They're just monitoring with LH search.
Right.
But Dr. Pamela, like we are monitoring all our patients who are coming for IUI, or so when we are calling them and we think that the follicle is mature enough, like on day 10, day 11. Whether the ovulation has occurred or not, in one cycle you can do a serum progesterone level 1 week after the LH search. That will confirm the ovulation also.
Very right. So I think patient compliance will be more, especially for us. We have more rural patients, and you know,
to go for ultrasound every alternate days, and if you can start using this LH search kit, it will become more patient friendly and more compliant.
Yeah, this is what we are starting now. So I just thought, you know, to have the discussion, because coming in this COVID time from home is not possible for patients, those who don't have their personal vehicles. So like some substitute, and I think this is the good discussion, and thank you for sharing. And next question is to Dr. Pamela. Now we talked about agonist trigger. Ma'am Nina has talked at length. What are the limitations of agonist trigger, Dr. Pamela?
This cannot be used in a long protocol in which already you have used the agonist for suppressing the pituitary. It can only be used in a short protocol, antagonist protocol. And in this case, because the corpus luteum luteolysis occurs very soon, so you have to give a very good luteal support as compared to HCG, because the half-life is very short. Okay. And in case of the fresh embryo transfer, when you are giving a GnRH agonist, the fresh embryo transfer gives a little lesser results, live birth rate, as compared to HCG.
And right. Even in hypogonadotrophic patients, that also we cannot give.
We have the question coming now, the content, because I just... It's for ourselves, and it's sort of revision, you know, what ma'am has talked. So next question to Deepankar, sir. Sir, what are the advantages of agonist trigger, indications for agonist trigger? And one more thing, sir, I would like to know from you, do we have to use it only in IVF patients or IUI patients?
Can Shiva? Yes.
Yes, sir.
See, this agonist trigger is a boon to an IVF clinic for free from OHSS. I tell you, this gives a very good relief. And the thing is, we are having good number of eggs with antagonist protocol nowadays, and we freeze everything and then we do a frozen embryo transfer. The problem with the gonadotropin, this GnRH trigger is agonist trigger is the agonist is creating a luteolysis, which Dr. Malhotra has already told you. And the second thing is, one thing you must have noticed, that even though it is luteolysis, but when we do a frozen embryo transfer in after putting a GnRH depot, so we make a pseudomenopause to the patient. And when we do, hormone replacement, their progesterone works well. But here, when it is luteolytic and there is no the luteal phase is in problem, even though we put lot amount of progesterone and estrogen, the pregnancy rate is very less. And I tell you, it is my experience that I tried a lot with assessing all luteal phase, estrogen and progesterone both. But the problem doesn't solve. There are pregnancies, but there are higher chances of abortion also.
That may be because of the asynchrony between the endometrial receptivity and the embryo.
No. There is a problem with, the HCG. Why HCG causes hyperstimulation? Because it stimulates VEGF. And the gonadotropin, which we give a trigger of analog, it inhibits the VEGF and it inhibits all the vascularization of the endometrium also, other than ovary and luteal also. So what happens when you do an embryo transfer in a triggered with GnRH analog, there will be problem with the endometrium, even though we support estrogen and progesterone and we maintain the estrogen and progesterone 20 and 200 respectively. But the problem with the GnRH trigger is that you cannot maintain that pregnancy very well, and you have to give, and the Americans, they put more injectable 100 mg per day injectable progesterone. And I tell you from my core of heart that I don't want to give that injection because it is created a lot of problem to my patients. But the thing is, the research and all, everything, it goes that you should give injectable progesterone, but I usually now avoid, and I do GnRH trigger to those patients where it crosses 3,000, 2,500 or 3,000 picogram of estradiol or in all oocyte donors.
Dr. Dipankar, this GnRH acts at the level of pituitary and it acts like a natural GnRH. How will it block VEGF? It's only the short.
No. It
is responsible for the poor luteal phase because
there are papers which I cannot quote in this discussion that it inhibits pituitary, but the whenever you give a 30, what I use leuprolide, that is 0.75 or 1 milligram of leuprolide. It should go and it should go down, and then there should be at least some relief from the inhibition of pituitary, or you should give estradiol and progesterone supplementation even though pituitary is stopped working. So, but even after that, whatever you do, the pregnancy rate is less. So it is not only the pituitary where it is working other areas also, and the amount of creating this vascularization is reduced. This is what I read in papers.
Dr. Pramila, what you want to ask is like when HCG acts, like sir wants to say that HCG is acting on all the levels. It is acting on the endometrium also, on the tubal mucosa also, and the eggs also. Whereas agonist is just acting on the oocyte. So what you talked about synchrony and what sir talked about progesterone estrogen, it's one and the same thing that as of today, we will all go for HCG trigger only. We go for agonist only and only when it's a donor cycle and there are multiple eggs. Dr. Sonu will agree with me, HCG is still the much favored trigger with us. So Dr. Sonu, you will add something. We go for HCG only, agonist is once in a while.
I only give for donors. I never give for cycles or for natural cycle. Only for donor. And if I want to freeze all the embryos, that's when I give the agonist.
Patients who are at high risk for OHSS.
Yeah, exactly.
Normal patients, doctor, we freeze all for all the patients who have their self like own cycles. We don't give agonist because sometimes there are empty follicles and it's a big loss for us and patient needs answer for every question.
Oh, Seema, I have started giving a dual trigger for these patients also. Like if I feel that the progesterone is high or the endometrium has fallen down. So right. Usually I give a dual trigger and freeze all the embryos, even if she's not at high risk of OHSS.
OHSS.
And then segmentation of the cycle.
Right. Thank you, Dr. Sonu. We have next question to Dr. Sonu.
Yeah.
So, what are the we are not giving agonist trigger as we have talked that we are doing more for the donors. But if it also has talked about the support also now estrogen progesterone. So, I just want to know what is better like small doses of HCG or estrogen progesterone. If you have to go, what will be your choice for that?
I usually give higher doses of estrogen and progesterone. I do progesterone level. On third day of and if it is less than 25, I usually give 1500 IU of HCG if I have done an embryo transfer for that patient.
Right.
Otherwise, I am not in favor of. I don't give low doses of HCG to these patients. So, estrogen 2 milligram 3 times a day till we do the pregnancy test and. Progesterone also, maybe I usually give 50 milligram intramuscular and 400 twice a day vaginal progesterone. And if it is low on the third day, then I give 1500 IU of HCG. That's what I give for the luteal phase support.
Right. So Dipankar sir, do you make any difference in your support or this is what everybody follows? Or the preparations now, the dermal preparations are coming of estrogen. Sir, do you prefer that? Are you using them?
No, I'm not using them.
And like but Dr. Nina also said, there are two approaches, European and American.
And American.
Americans are usually estrogen and progesterone, and Europeans, right, they give lower doses of FCG.
That will almost eliminate risk of OHSS.
Yeah, exactly.
Right.
But usually, when you are giving GnRH agonist as trigger, you are freezing all and transferring in the next cycle.
Yes, that is what is being followed. Thank you, Dr. Sonu. Next question to Dr. Pramila. What are the contraindications of agonist trigger? Like Dr. Sonu has started, so I just told her. What are the contraindications?
For agonist trigger is when you have, in a long protocol, when you have used GnRH agonist to downregulate the pituitary. So you can't use it as a trigger.
No, other conditions like patient is hypogonadotropic or patient is on OCPs. Okay. Dr. Sonu, you would add something?
Mostly agonist, like Dr. Pramila said, if we are doing an agonist long protocol cycle, and it does not work in hypogonadotrophic, hypogonadic patients.
Right.
So we have to give HCG trigger, even if they have multiple follicles, so there is a risk of hyperstimulation. But still in those patients, we manage them with giving IV fluids and colloids and proteins infusion.
If the pituitary is working all right and it is only hypothalamic amenorrhea, that case it will work.
Hypothalamic dysfunction, right. You cannot...
we need your expert comments.
No, there is no contraindication. Contraindication is nothing for agonist trigger because if you are not have the facility of freezing, then this is a great contraindication. And the thing is, one thing is very simple, that HCG gives a better pregnancy always. Even though if you support luteal phase with slight amount of HCG, the pregnancy rate is always good. So I always try to give some HCG in my HCG triggered patients also. And the even in agonist trigger, if we add HCG on the day of when we are doing ovum pickup, I came across ovarian hyperstimulation of a severe variety. So I usually don't give. But as a contraindication to agonist, already it has been told that if hypothalamus and pituitary is working well, no problem. But if you have down-regulated those, even hypo-hypo, this patient, they are coming, you cannot use, because if they are not working, then to whom they will stimulate.
Thank you, sir. And next question we have to sir, Dipankar, sir. What are the signs of trigger failure, sir? For us to know, you will know before giving trigger, but we have to have some guidelines, sir.
Signs of trigger failure, what is the meaning of that? That you are not getting any eggs.
Yes, sir.
So, what trigger you are giving, that is HCG or GnRH, I will give two answers.
Right, sir.
What I faced in my day-to-day practice is quality of HCG number one. Yes. The amount of HCG number one is not correct. Patient was telling that they put injection, but injection was not put properly. All the fluid came out. And when I did pick up, then one side I started and I asked my wife that whether eggs are there or not. There are no eggs, then I stop. And then I usually don't do after 24 hours of giving a rescue HCG. I do 36 hours and I am quite successful in that. And with the trigger, if it is by GnRH analog, then whatever drug you are using for trigger, titrate it well, because do a serum LH and progesterone after 12 to 18 hours, which I do with my what I am using as a GnRH trigger.
Right, sir.
That LH, sir, should be there. It should be more than 15 or 16, and there should be a high amount, 3.5 or 4 nanogram of progesterone. So if that is there, then you are sure that your trigger is working and it will work next day. Otherwise, I had this problem with GnRH trigger while titrating, because the dose is there, but when you put into the patient, then with that patient, at least you should see two or three patients doing serum LH and progesterone, at least LH next day at 12 o'clock, because in my clinic, I am putting this at 12:30 in the night. So next day at 12 o'clock or 1 o'clock, I call her and do serum LH. If they are there, then signs of trigger failure, the problem of trigger failure is usually less. The question of this empty follicle syndrome, I think it is a myth. And if HCG is not good, it happens with what in previous webinar you asked about IVM. If you don't put good, so HCG, which creates detachment or LH surge by GnRH analog trigger, gives a detachment, and that is cell to cell junction, which reduces between the murine and coronacumulus cells. So that is very important with HCG, and HCG is definitely a better trigger for pregnancy.
So, sir, like, what is the take home that we do LH and progesterone in cases where we are suspecting that there might be a failure or patient has failed IVF?
Wherever you do your program, IVF program, you standardize your program with your drugs. You usually use single type of drugs for a long time. So if you change that drug, please standardize that drug by doing at least 2-3 patients when you are using GnRH trigger, to see whether that trigger with your dose, even though it is written in book that this dose is enough, but do yourself. It is very simple test. Then you can get
sometimes at least, you have batch to batch.
Yes. There might be, but batch to batch variation with a good quality company is usually not there. But sir, dosing is very important.
Do you always do LH and progesterone?
Not every case.
So in the signs, like we would only come to know that the trigger has failed if we have started a pregnancy, and in 4-5 follicles we do not get any oocytes. I'm just asking. I'm not
contradicting.
The question is very correct.
Because this happened with me many years back. I had an agonist trigger in a donor. And in a donor, I did not get even a single oocyte.
Yes, I think we all have suffered somewhere, sir.
So that was actually devastating. How do you answer to the patient that you have recruited a donor and still you are not getting any?
That was my idea of keeping this question, because then you are in a soup and you don't know how to answer the patient. And like somewhere, so the homework was not complete.
Even it is not possible that for a donor, you start doing LH and progesterone every time you give an agonist trigger.
Cost is always the concern.
I have started giving a dual trigger. I give 1500 or 2000 IU of HCG along with agonist.
Because definitely, for most of the donor, it is very good way. Yes. It is a good way of practice. Yes.
So that's like, I just wanted to share my experience, because I'm not doing LH and progesterone. But in most of the papers, they say after 8 to 12 hours of agonist trigger, you do an LH and progesterone.
Right.
If it is less than 15 and progesterone less than 3, so that usually is an indication that the trigger may have failed.
Right. I think that was good share. And we shift to now next question.
That is the best way of doing in patient with egg donor if they are not hyperstimulated.
This question, Dr. Formula, if we are given agonist trigger, we have already discussed actually, but if you are given a choice, you will go for fresh embryo or frozen embryo transfer?
Freeze all.
Yes, freeze all. I think, sir, that is the final answer from all of you, sir. Dr. Sonu?
Yes.
Okay, so we go to next question. Next question to Dr. Sonu. And ma'am has already discussed, so what is the ideal dose of agonist that you are giving at your center? That is all we want to know.
Agonist, usually I'm giving, if I'm giving this Lupride, I give 1 milligram. And if the patient is obese, then 2 milligram. Right. And if I'm giving Triptorelin, then that is 0.1 milligram. And rarely I have used 0.2. And these are two. And along with that, I give 1500 or 2000 IU of HCG.
All this. So you would like to add anything, or we proceed to next question, sir?
Please proceed. This is the we have already discussed.
Right, sir. Thank you.
We can give this Triptorelin till 4 milligram. I have used for 2 or 3 patients, and that can be given till 4 milligram also.
even if the patient is at high risk for OHSS, still you give a low dose of HCG with agonist?
Ma'am, usually I give, and so that when I'm doing a pickup, I give them colloid, and I explain to the patient that you always for a week you have to have high protein diet, and daily you have to take at least 2 packets of ORS and all other.
Do you have any upper limit of estradiol levels in which you will not give the HCG? You will give only the agonist trigger. You have the, because as they say, if it is less than more than 3500, you should avoid giving it.
Theoretically, it is correct, but I usually, for cost effectiveness, maybe I don't do an estrogen level, and mostly I rely on my ultrasound findings. So if they have more than 15 follicles, which are more than 17, 18, then I usually don't give, like I give only 1000 or 1500 IU. Because that after those two donors, I have become very vigilant about it, that I should not get that experience again.
I think both are right. Dr. Pamela is also right. We should do estradiol wherever. And Dr. Sohn is also right. Because once you look at the follicle, automatically, you know, by experience, you come to know that estrogen is going to be high. So why waste money and just go to whatever. So now this question is, Dr. Pamela, what are the predictors of empty follicle syndrome? This is very, very disgusting and depressing situation.
Empty follicle syndrome is when you have induced the patient, when you have had a controlled ovarian stimulation for IVF, and when you aspirate the mature follicles, you don't get any oocyte in any of the follicle. And usually it is an indicator of poor ovarian reserve. AMH less than 0.5 is usually considered that the patient will have.
Ma'am, I will not agree with you, because if the patient has 0.5 AMH, we can get 2 or 3.
We can get. I'm saying if you get it, it may be, it is not always. Even with AMH 0.4, 0.3, patients have conceived naturally also.
But ma'am, even empty follicle syndrome, like predictors, I usually don't think there is any syndrome as empty follicle syndrome. Maybe there was some human error in the trigger. Or
maybe
like
the trigger was not given at the proper time. The oocytes were still immature and the trigger was given, or the premature LH surge was not taken care of.
So what all we have discussed till now, maybe that was the, that had led to empty follicle syndrome. Because if we are giving a trigger at a proper time and proper dosage, then I don't know, maybe Seema, you and Dr. Dipankar can share some more experience about that. But I have usually not come across.
So I want to share actually, well, there was one PCOS patient, and you know, she was making such good follicles, almost all 25, 20, and when we aspirated all the follicles, there was no single oocyte we could retrieve, and we had to tell her that these are not good quality follicles and this is empty follicle, and all details were given to her, and the surprise was that after 2 or 3 months she conceived on her own. So maybe like what in PCO we see, that the stale eggs are coming up again and then they are suppressed and they again come crop up, and we just aspirate once and then there is the new crop coming. So Dipankar sir would surely add to our query and answer. What is there anything like empty follicle syndrome, and is the doctor at fault or there is something wrong with the patient? Sir, your expert comments.
One thing I want to mention, that wherever we do IVF, I always tell that have a great control on endocrine of the IVF, because you cannot, it doesn't create lot of expenses, but it gives you very good control and very good confidence, number one. Number two, I already told you that I use in low AMH when there is lesser estradiol, that is less than 1000, or I am expecting less than 4 oocyte. I give 15,000 HCG. I tell you very sincerely, because if your HCG is lesser than what is required to start maturation of oocyte, every one of us must have experienced that when we do pickup, all follicles, they don't give us good M2, or even not a single. You aspirated 10, you get 6 or 7 oocyte. Where are the other 3? It should have come. Either it may be in GV stage or M1 stage or M2 stage, but my embryologist don't get 10 out of 10 oocytes. So it comes in my mind, what happens with those oocytes, which are there also growing follicle. The things come that the things come that whenever is there is a requirement of LH surge to the ovary requires good amount of LH amount in every follicle. So it might be a problem with the few follicle which doesn't give oocyte. Those follicles are empty, but it never happens like that. I don't get any follicle from any oocyte from any follicle. If it happens and my embryologist says there are no follicles after 5 or 6 aspiration, what you told about your PCOD, stop there. Take another chance of giving HCG or GnRH trigger. It will help, because if you give a good amount of HCG or GnRH trigger, if it's on antagonist, I tell you, every time I got a second rescue and it gives a good pregnancy, it doesn't give any very great disturbance to the treatment. So one thing is that you should have a great control over the IVF cycle with what Dr. Promila told, that whenever you do IUI, start with the day 2 basic. Otherwise, whatever you are using, or if you are using LH kit, you don't know what is happening inside. And the thing is, if you do ultrasound without doing a basic and at the time of when you are giving LH or trigger, at least do some endocrine, though you will have a better chance whether she is having 3000 or 3500 picogram. If a donor is having 3500 or 4000 picogram and you want maximum oocyte to collect, I will never use HCG, because I will better put some money in second day of giving an LH trigger and do a LH on second day. It will cost me 500 or 600 rupees, but it gives me a great help that the lady had a good LH surge and she will not going to have hyperstimulation syndrome. Moment you put little amount of HCG, even small amount of HCG creates havoc. So it is my that the prediction of empty follicle syndrome is we or the patient, that if we are not given a proper amount of HCG, good quality HCG, or patient has not taken, then it is a good predictor. But if you don't get any eggs from the follicle, stop there, redo it with fresh HCG or analog trigger, you will get good success.
If the LH surge is not taken care of, could it also be responsible for that? If we don't take care of the natural premature LH surge by giving antagonist, could all that also be responsible for?
If you are doing, that is why I'm telling, if you are doing a proper IUI or IVF, one thing should be a paramount of, that is very important, that is inhibit premature LH surge. If you are not doing that, then you are not, I tell you, you are not doing justice, because people do clomiphene citrate, letrozole, okay, no problem. But if you want to actually help that patient, then have a control over premature LH surge. You become the pituitary, you become the manager, you manage that thing. Yes. It will be a little bit extra, but you will give a good justice to the patient.
Yes. Sir, any role of AMH, like Dr. Pamela and Dr. Sonu discussed just now. So what is the minimum lowest AMH you take for self-stimulation and not for donor cycle? Like we say less than 0.6, or you should go for donor. So what is your recommendation to the patient? What is the lowest level of AMH where we should
There is my way of working or principle is that the lady is menstruating and my duty is that offer her to have a baby with her own biological egg.
Very right, sir.
Exactly.
But the literature doesn't support that, sir. And the moment you tell
doesn't matter. If you see my I'm having a channel also and putting this lot of testimonials and all. 0.03 AMH from 2 clinic. Advised egg donation, but she is having regular period. I put her on dual stimulation. I didn't get good quality egg in follicular phase. Next day I started luteal phase stimulation. I get 2 blastocysts in second luteal phase stimulation. I freeze them and did a frozen embryo transfer. She conceived. So
sir, what did you give for luteal phase stimulation? What did you use?
It is a follicular phase stimulation followed by
luteal phase. What did you give, sir? HMG-FSH, what was?
No, that is very, one thing should be very clear, that whenever you do follicular phase, give a GnRH analog trigger.
Right, sir.
GnRH analog trigger, there will be a luteolysis of the whatever you did in this cycle.
Right, sir.
But there will be a second wave and you have already downregulated immediately that patient. So you have a second cohort of egg, which are primordial primordial follicles. They will get selected with your stimulation. Stimulate them. Do another pickup. Here also give GnRH analog trigger. Luteal phase, in my experience, in literature also says, luteal phase, you get even in a very low AMH, few eggs. I tell you, Seema, one thing very clear, that there should be a great amount of understanding between the couple and the doctor, and the couple should know what I am doing.
Right, sir. That is important.
So it is matter of thing that it is the last ditch effort which we can do, at least if you are menstruating. If you go the Poseidon method of working, then there are, I think there is one group called group 4, where they have very low AMH with more than 35 years of age group, and they give a lot of supplements and dual stimulation. I went through that literature also.
So DHEAs and all, you have any role here, like 2 months prior, DHEAs 80 milligrams?
You asked me previously also, but yes, I used DHEA, but if you want to use DHEA, please use for at least 3 months prior to your stimulation.
You talked about testosterone patches also, sir, also?
Yes, testosterone patches or testosterone gel. Nowadays, there is another company which comes with a bottle. You can dispense it from that bottle also. If you want to use that, use it, no problem. I have at least 2 or 3 oocytes, if I can get with M2 oocyte to my embryologist, do ICSI and freeze them. So it is a matter that what will happen. I will stop in between. Otherwise, if I have good quality, then I will continue. This understanding with the couple and with me is great.
Yeah, I would like to add, sir, that I usually counsel my patient that if, like, this is the situation, your AMH is low, and if you can put in the money and the time, then I would like, even with the less than 0.5 AMH, I usually do their own cycle first, and the pregnancy does not happen, then go on to a donor cycle. Otherwise, I usually don't offer a...
It is not the AMH, low AMH, always eggs are finished or bad. There might be good quality eggs, but in lesser number.
And even doing a baseline scan and seeing the antral follicle on day 2, that also gives a fair amount of idea that what the patient may come up with.
AMH just gives you the ovarian reserve, not the quality of the oocytes. If the quality of the oocytes is good, I have one patient whose AMH, she is premature ovarian insufficiency. Her AMH was 0.03 and she has conceived without IVF.
Yeah, exactly. So you never know in science what happens with the patient.
That's what I'm saying. No, we are still not aware of all these miracles happening. We don't know exactly the quality of egg she is carrying. If the quality of the egg is carrying, there is no male factor, no tubal factor. This AMH just guides you.
Yeah, exactly.
Sometimes it's doctor's luck, you know, that helps patient, Dr. Pamela.
It is a doctor's doctor's courage and confidence.
Right, sir. Agreed, sir. You are giving us important tips. Very nice and interesting.
AMH less than 0.4 have conceived without IVF. So many patients.
Agreed, yes. So next question to Dr. Sonu Balhara. For any effect of trigger on endometrial gene expressions, this will answer question of Dr. Pamela also, like why we are giving HCG trigger or agonist trigger. So is there any effect on endometrial gene expression or something?
I went through the literature and today I saw a paper where they have said that there is effect of this trigger on gene expression. And that affects the implantation and receptivity of the endometrium. So if we are giving the same what even Dr. Neena had talked, if we are giving a good luteal support with agonist trigger, so and they have done this paper in donor cycles, and they've done a day 5 biopsy. So they have detected this gene expression effect. So there is definitely an effect of the trigger on the gene expression.
Yeah, so and they have recommended that HCG is any day better when it comes to effect on endometrium.
So can I?
Actually, they have studied the window of implantation, basically, which starts from the when the blastocyst stage is there, 5 days after the ovulation. And if you're giving the HCG, because it maintains the corpus luteum and the progesterone levels are maintained, right. So it's always better with the agonist, better than the agonist trigger. And it lasts around 4-5 days, 5-6 days.
Precisely. Yes, sir?
Can I? Now, I want to share one thing that you must have noticed that whenever we give HCG trigger, the HCG trigger stimulates endometrial receptivity for immediately. And whenever we give high amount, which is an artificial LH trigger and very high half-life, so just like pituitary down regulates when GnRH analog is given, in the same way endometrium gets down regulated. When endometrium gets down regulated, it gets down regulated for 3 days. And you must have noticed that after 3 days, there is a regeneration of those receptors, and on window of implantation at day 5 or 6, they recover back. And it has been shown that those blastocysts which are having HCG secretion, which is start from 8 cell. The gene expression of the HCG starts from 8 cell, but it gives started and trophoectoderm gives the best expression. Those blastocysts which has good HCG expression gets implanted in spontaneous pregnancy. This is proved. So whenever you do day 5 blastocyst transfer with HCG trigger of 10,000, you must have noticed that day 3 transfer and day 5 transfer, the day 5 transfers are better. Why? Because there is down regulation of HCG receptors or HCG, whichever it causes the expression of addition and apposition, those interleukins and leukemia factor. I don't want to go in that detail, but they get down regulated, they get released from 4th day.
Very right, sir. Agreed. Totally. And I think you've explained it so well. Next question to Dr. Pramila. Yes. In PCOS, when we are giving the trigger, do these criteria differ or the same criteria we follow?
PCOS patients, they are hyper-responders usually. So we have to be very careful about the OHSS. And if the patient is a hyper-responder, to avoid the OHSS, we always give a GnRH agonist trigger and start with a short protocol, give GnRH agonist trigger and freeze all to avoid OHS.
Right. Sir, you want to add anything, sir?
No, this is, we have already discussed this. PCOS, yes, is a hyper responder. So.
Right. So I'm really happy, sir. We are getting answers from every expert, and like it's just unfolding all the queries in our mind and it's really helping us. And the last question to Deepankar, sir, and then all the panelists can give the inputs. So last question is to sir. Sir, your experience with luteal phase support with recombinant HCG. And what is luteal coasting, sir? We would like to know from you, sir.
Both the things I don't do.
So this is just a repetition. And for the poor students, you have to revise your lecture again. So
about the luteal coasting, I think, Seema, we had talked. No,
that recombinant HCG.
Right, sir.
The recombinant
we are not HCG giving recombinant, well. Neither Dr. Sonu or Dr. Pramila, we are not giving recombinant, sir, but you must be giving. So what is your criteria for giving
coasting
recombinant?
Is actually one coasting is to avoid the OHSS when you have got more than 20 follicles of more than 10 millimeters and serum estradiol more than 3500, that posting is you stop the gonadotropins and start the GnRH antagonist till you get appropriate E2 levels. And if you have to go for more than 3 days of posting, you have to cancel the cycle because the results are not good. And second is luteal phase posting. Luteal phase posting is, as Dr. Neena has already described, which you call as double trigger, because when you are giving a GnRH agonist as a trigger, doing the fresh sample, fresh embryo transfer, then the luteolysis is there. Either you have to give with HCG, so small doses of HCG with the progesterone. This is known as luteal posting. You get the serum progesterone levels done. And if the levels are falling to a level with the progesterone only, then you support it with a HCG level, small doses of 1,000 or 1,500 international units.
I sometimes do luteal posting when I have to transfer fresh embryo
luteal
transfer.
Luteal phase posting.
That time I do a serum progesterone on day 3. And then if it is less than 25, then I usually increase my dose of progesterone.
Yes.
And give an HCG also, small amount.
One posting is to avoid the OHSS. Second posting is to support the luteal phase.
That is follicular phase posting. Hello. This one is luteal phase.
Sir, during follicular phase, whenever we are reducing the level, the gonadotropins, usually what I feel that egg quality is not as good as when it is either uniform or it is escalating dose. So, sir, this is the final question and final take from you. And before we conclude, sir, anything you want to add or you want to tell us?
Regarding this gonadotropin dose?
Yes, sir. And yes.
Suppose you are doing, I tell you as a practical point of view, suppose you are doing a GnRH analog downregulated cycle and you feel that it might go to hyperstimulation and you don't have any choice to give other than HCG trigger and it will create problem. And if you expect this on day 8, day 7, you can make it out how many follicles are growing. Stop GnRH analog and start GnRH antagonist on the same day.
Yes, sir.
And convert it into GnRH analog trigger. Lot of things will be saved and your cycle will be saved and there will not be any ovarian hyperstimulation syndrome. Second thing, if you are doing HCG trigger and if you are maintaining the cycle and if you see, if you do an endocrine assay before HCG and LH is rising more than 5 or 10 and progesterone is also increasing 1.5 little bit more. And if you are using antagonist, double the dose of antagonist. These things help me in my day-to-day practice. So, and if you feel have a fear that there will be more rupture of the follicle, then I use prostaglandin inhibitors also.
Thank you, sir. You made it the finest and most accurate support system for today's panel. And all the inputs from you, Dr. Sonu and Dr. Pramila were really promising and really glad to have this wonderful panel. And thank you, Neena Malhotra ma'am, for the wonderful talk, Dr. Vedehi, Dr. Sunita and Dr. Tripti for chairing the session. Yes, sir.
Seema, I must give you a very big compliment that I first time I see that person is maintaining this type of show continuously and such a good communicator. And I really, I'm giving you a lot of compliments from my side that at least you have created an atmosphere to learn the thing from different experts. Very nice. And I really compliment you and congratulate you.
Yes, that is really very complimentary to you that you have organized it very well. Thank you so much for inviting us. And thank you to all the organizers and Jaksanpal.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Your blessings mean a lot to me. And so this is a stimulus. Everybody is supported in the event. We started with Dr. Abha and just continuing like 7 days, 7 scholars were such a hit. And all credit to the team Jaksanpal and Dr. Deepika, who has been such a strong support with us, and it's really helping all over. And I wish more and more persons could attend because this is face to face with the experts. And sir has been our favorite since we met him, and trying to make good students to him because his knowledge is so vast. He starts from inception, and we are like when we go to a spiritual guru. Guru says, "Forget what you know when you are coming to me." but we go with that mind. So same is with the Pankaj sir. If we have to learn from him, we have to unlearn things which we have learned earlier. So sir, we are trying
to be better. Itna nahi chadhate.
Yeah, I mean it. So thank you, Deepika ji, and over to you on behalf of Rivadi.
And I am not so senior also, Seema. Don't make me so senior, you know.
Sir, we also not so junior. So we don't look actually. So it's been 27 years when I passed my MD in 93. So, but it's always a pleasure to learn from others. And really, we are thankful on behalf of Rivadi of Training Society to all our panelists and our chairpersons and speakers. And we would like to meet again and again in future. And today, it was really good sharing. Thank you, Dr. Pramila, Dr. Sonu, Deepankar, sir. And over to you, Dr. Deepika.
Before we close, I must congratulate Seema for conducting and moderating the session so well. These webinars, you're continuing with a lot of enthusiasm. That's very well appreciated.
Thank you very much on behalf of Jackson Pal, makers of Cestilia M, the right combination of 40:1 ratio of myo-inositol, dichiro-inositol, the long-acting GnRH agonist, leuprolide acetate 3.75 mg is our injection gonadoreg. Also, Lycorate Preg sachet with L-arginine, DHA and lycopene to avoid pregnancy complications. So I'm Dr. Deepika, along with my teammates. We all thank all the experts for sharing such vast knowledge with us today. We are truly appreciative of the presence of all the attendees. We hope to go a long way in knowledge sharing with your unending support. We express our gratitude to all for participating and look forward to your presence in our next webinar. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you.